So, good morning, everyone. I'm Stavros Anastasiadis. Now, I work with Thesso Electronic as a software developer and core Python developer. Now, my personal background is not with computer science stuff like that. I originally studied forestry, and I have some studies in hydrology. So, in some point, I have decided to put Python in my life, and I became a Python geek. So, I'm like Python, as you can tell. So I was trying to prepare this presentation, and I was thinking what would be the best also for developers and also for the ones that we have like streamcasting right now. So I thought, okay, let's compare the two frameworks. Okay, by starting, Frappe is a full stack web framework, and Django is not so full stack. So the thing is, the Django quotes like it's a web framework for developers with deadlines. So I will try to compare how easy it is to set up your Django project and how easy to set up is your Frappe project. I'm basically a Linux user. So I will show you the commands, and during the presentation I will give you some tips like what I use like daily for using bends and stuff like that. So probably I will be the only technical presentation, but it's a nice. So let's start from installing. Now, in the Django world and in every Python project, you do something like you create your folder, then you create a virtual environment where you have isolated your Python container, let's say, and then you just pip install Django 1.8. I'm using like the long term, okay? And on the same time, on the Frappe world, you have to install bends. Now, everyone is very afraid of bends, like bend stop, where is it, and stuff like that. So we clone from the main repository. By default, when you clone in the bends repository, you give the namespace of bends repo, and then you have a bends install slash c bends repo. Basically, you are doing the same thing like pip install. It's the same thing, but you are using a library, a Python library that is called Click. So bends is using a clip, using a Python library called Clip. And basically, when you bends install does it, you so only say I'm installing something that is editable. So you can change the code on the bends, and then you have it again to your console. Now, the way to think about bends in comparison with Django stuff like that, you have to think bends is like not only a tool toolkit, it's a toolkit with power tools. What I mean by that, it gives you the ability to switch between development and production very easily. Okay, and also you have to use bends for some infrastructure because it's very easy. If you see the tutorial they have in Click, it's very easy, and if you go like from the and it's well-documented library. So if you go to the source code of bends, you will find yourself. If you go to the source code of bends, that is not ready right now. Sorry, I will not go deeper to source code, but to get the feeling, like if you follow the tutorial in the Clip library, then you can write your own bends commands. It's that easy. Okay, now. So basically we have like a manager or a packet manager to work on. Now, the second step is to create the file structure you want. So in the Django world, you have like bends, you have a Django admin terminal command, and you start a project and you give a name. Now, for this presentation, as you can tell, I told you I'm a geek, so I'm using Batman as my reference. So in the Frappe world, you have bends init. Now, init is not so okay. It may be yes or no, but we have to live with it. So the choice is made. Bends init maybe is not the correct word, but here is something that I use all the time. Because I want to have like a stable system, I don't want to use every day the develop branch that they have. I use this dash frappe branch master. So I'm tracking master. I'm tracking frappe master branch. And so I'm like waiting when an admin will merge something new, when I will get a new version. So then I'm going back to my system and updating my system very easily. With only that setup, you have already, with in Frappe World, with only this command, you have already gained all the crazy develop push requests that be done every day. So I think it's a good start. Of course, like you have in Django, we already have a cell. So for us, it's Bench console. It's the same thing. You are inside. The thing is that in Django World cell, let's say, you have to use another, if you want another application, in order to load all the documents or all the models. By default in Frappe, it's already there. So you can, you don't have to import Frappe. Frappe is there. The library is there. So right now, I have just downloaded source code, some of the source code, my manager. I have created some structure, and I'm getting ready to set up the init process. Now, in the Django world, you have to migrate. First, you have to create your database. You migrate, create the database. And then you probably have to create a super user, like the admin, in order to use some of the features of Django. Now, the thing is, by default, because Django is so customizable, it gives you like SQLite, you can choose Postgres, you can choose whatever database. But this means also you have to configure this database. And this is where Frappe comes and says, OK, we have made the choice. The choice MariaDB. It's an excellent open source database. You don't have to worry about keeping track or maintain what will happen next in, for example, Postgres. Will I have to switch? This is all done by the guys. It's fairly good. And you get like a small installation terminal or command that you just give your SQL root password, MySQL root password, and you have the first thing you install Frappe and some weird country info. I don't understand what is this, but this is what you get by default. So by default, you get the framework and you install also, you get the administration. You don't have to put some create super user. You get it by default. And by default, the schedule is the same. So we have now, we have downloaded the source code. We have a structure of files. We are getting to init. And in Frappe, init also means that you have to put a site. So now, the first thing you notice when you are starting with Frappe is every site you create, it generates a hash for the database. Now, the hash generator they have is very good. You can even, if you see the function they have, you can even select a length. So, for example, we use every day a hash generator for some batch stuff like that. So you can make a unique identifier with 4 characters, stuff like that. And I always use this other option. This is just a bench command, and another option, DB name. So I have my name, and I know which databases I'm working on. If you think about it, you probably will say, okay, why not they don't have it like by default? You have to put the database name. If you go, if you remember the cloud service they have, so they have so millions now. Like yesterday, we created so many new instances of Frappe. So if everyone was trying to create a name, maybe we'll have some conflicts like your name is there, stuff like that. But if you are starting to work with Frappe in more serious matters, you can even have your database name set up during the init process. So now, starting the developer server, it's the first big thing you will face, like how I do development. So we have bench start. It starts so many processes, starts some Redis service from the background, stuff like that. In Django world, it's more easy. You just type Python manager. But the thing is how you configure the settings now. Now, in the Django world, you have a file called settings. You have a list of variables that you have to configure, database, templates, what time zone, stuff like that. Also, every application you might install needs some extra configuration, so you end up with a huge file. In Frappe world, it's much easier. Rusab yesterday told us about the common site JSON file you can have your common settings, but each site has its own setting using the site config. Now, I don't think if you have digging after the source code of Frappe, there is something here. It is called apps Frappe data. So, apps Frappe data, and they have this JSON file. So they have this JSON file that you can configure everything. You can start like, you know, realizing what you can do. So they have a sample site config, but it's, I think they don't even remember that they have it. I think it's like, you know, you have to search a lot to find it. But basically, you get so many options, and you get so good things. So, for example, this is something they forgot. Like, now you have Celery, but you are using Redis. Something was used to be Celery. But you can, use this one very easily. Let me... So, right now, I can start some development server. Let's compare the two frameworks, what they give from scratch. I will go from Django and then to Frappe. Sorry for doing this. Now, the first thing you get now, this is up and running on my localhost in one port. So the first thing you get with that configuration you just saw from using this command, it's just a plain text saying it worked, congratulations, you have your Django power. This is good. You say, okay, I'm working. Then another cool feature that the Django has is the slash admin. So you get an admin panel, and the only thing you get is how to manage some groups, users and groups. It's the same thing. Users have permissions. They can do stuff. You don't have any other thing. This is what you get. On the other hand, when you have like starting your Frappe, nothing more, not just with no custom application, you get this. You get the homepage with a login setting. You have already signed up. You have also already the forgotten password. If you are familiar with any Django development, you have to use an app that is called Django Registration. Maybe you want some Facebook authentication. You have to use another app. By default, Frappe has it all. So I'm logging as administrator. I'm switching to desk. And this is what I get. Gadget Manager is not on the default. But you get the tools. You get a newsletter. By default, you can configure your mail and you can set newsletters. You have email groups, you have a to-do app. I know that there are people that use to-do and they have expanded to-do so much that it's the main module, the main thing that they do all the day. From to-do, he can track, like he wants to track his employee, what they do every day. So he took to-do and make it even better. You have file management, you have calendar, you have chat, notes, activity. Also, something else, it gives you a website. The website is a portal that you, by default, create your own web pages. So, imagine the scenario. We want to create 100 websites that they have. A homepage, an about page, a contact page, and stuff like that. By default, you can create 100 sites, and you have it all. You create just a theme, maybe. You can switch easily to themes. So this is a standard one. So let me give you something like, I will name it test. I will go to this. So the thing I wanted to show you there, because it's based on Bootstrap, you can go get like, there's a service, get Bootstrap, that you can take themes like paper, newspaper, they have like several themes. You just paste the CSS and out of the box it will work. So you can have like, for all these 100 websites, you can have your own theming. So it's very cool to have it by default. This is the good thing. Website setup. Also, you have a portal setup, knowledge base. So you have a blog engine ready. You can expand. If you want to write a blog in Django, you have to write everything by your own. It's very it's not so. It used to be very hard. Now, anyway, there's a project that is making it easier. But by default, you get so much functionality. You may say, I don't need it, but actually you need it, because in the world we are living right now, everyone wants everything by default. So right now there is no customer that will come and say to you, okay, I want a site, nothing more, just plain HTML or some CSS. It will tell you, I want the site, I want to have this email, I want to be able to send emails, I want to be having maybe a newsletter. Maybe he will call you, oh, I need a new page, so you don't have to configure everything. Now, so battery is included, the defaults. I think on this case, again, Frappe is very good. Now, creating custom application. Now, in the Django world, you have to go and say, okay, I want to start an application, and I will call it gadget management. Then I have to go to my settings file. I have a list of the default settings the install apps they have, and I have to put my own. And then I have to migrate my database. I have to create URLs about this custom application, and so on and so on. Frappe has made the best job for this. So you just create a new app, and then you install the app to the website. It gives you this awesome prompt that you can, like, you can give the title, description, publisher, the license, everything without from you, like from the developer side, like to find the license, the correct license. Where do I put the license file? And stuff like that. By default, everything is there. By default also, when you create an application, you have I'm taking as example, a model, okay. My model is a gadget. Batman has gadgets. He needs gadgets to survive. He has this gadget has a title, description, and image. Now, in the Django world, in order to write this model, you have to go to create a models py, and then you have to create a class. This class inherits from models.models. You have to use this char field, but you have to predefine what is the max length. Maybe it's unique, maybe not. You have to create the description. You have an image field. Yes, they have some things that you have to configure. They also will suggest you to go to another application, Django ImageKit, in order to have image. So I want just a model with three fields. And from the Django perspective, I have to sit around like 2 or 3 hours. Not like because I don't know Django, because I have to think that this is the correct name for my model. If I put this name and change it later, I have to think about the migration. It's not a simple process, for example, to change name. Let's say title is not correct. We need something else. So Frappe, as you know, has the doc type. And you can create doc types easily from the awesome bar, search bar, they say. And this doc type inherits from document. Now, where this is on the source code, if you go to code doctype.py, you will find the source code. Now, you may think about it like from frappe.model input document. So maybe you have the scenario that you want every model in your database to have a specific field for some reason. So you can take this document, because every doctype is a document, and then from that, to inherit it to a new class, and you use it by default. So maybe by default, you need some new field to the whole system. It's very easy because it's just Python. Okay. So Batman needs to do some stuff. He needs to upload. He needs to find suppliers. He needs to he needs to create, read, update, and delete. So how you register your model with Just Create? In the Django world, you have to go to a special file called admin.py. You have to register. So you have to import your model, and then you have to register to the site area. Now, if your model in the admin area, you want it to be more complex, you have to do some manual configuration, like this inherited from another class and stuff like that. In the Frappe world, as you all know, this is one of the biggest thing they have. They have simple gadget manual. You have a list, you have a form to create, you have a detailed form to view, you have comments, you have a sidebar that you can customize, or images, very easily done. So right now, if I had to work like for this project, like from scratch, I will be with Frappe in 15 minutes ready. With Django, I will spend like an hour. And most of the hour will be only configuration. Now, for me, the best thing that Frappe has is this REST API they use. The decorator Frappe.whitelist, it must be the most awesome thing I have seen. Because everywhere I want, inside the framework, I can create my own API methods. This gives me so much flexibility to give to my service whatever they need. Again, in the Django world, you have to configure, you have to take the request, you have to do something with the request, you have to say this request is not, it's JSON. You have to do it by yourself. And then there is another framework called, this is actually a framework on top of Django, it's called Django REST that everyone uses. Now, out of the box also, you get a login system. Even if you weren't going to use, for example, Django REST, you have to use another application, it's called Django REST Auth, in order to have logins. So in order to manage session between users, you have to use something else. This is where Frappe, for me, is one of the best features. Out of the box, you have a login, logout, registration, whatever your service needs. By default, you get resolve the doc type, and also by default, you get filters. You get filters about your data. So you don't even have, like, for example, you don't have to write a special API call or a special endpoint that your user will pass their fields and stuff like that. By default, it's there. You can list by name, by field name, whatever. You have also by default pagination. So I will give you a rough scenario how to use it, to use only REST APIs, to use only Frappe for the REST API. Someone asks you to create a mobile application. Okay. So the first thing you have to do, you're going to think, okay, I need an API to connect with the mobile, stuff like that. You have Frappe by default in 15 minutes, everything ready for you. So my presentation is very short because I didn't want to. So this is my daughter, Danai. And so, for us, is the quote. This is why Frappe is a superhero web framework. You have to understand and you have to put it in your mind that you are not using a web framework. You are truly using a superhero web framework. So, thank you.